So, okay, so last time we saw one remark, so define f of u integral over omega f of grad u dx for any u in beta. Omega say is bounded with with Lipschitz boundary, say. And suppose that G, did I use G? Yes, G is given. And so now I emphasize that f is in our lectures has been always 1/2 psi squared. But several things that I will say remain true whenever f in general, say f, say is smooth, smooth, strictly convex, and say also now we will see if we need something. If you want, you can fix, to fix idea, you can think like this. In this case, it is called the Dirichlet integral. So we saw last time that the following remark, I think, that was suppose that u is a solution solves inf then minus Laplace of u in omega. So, and of course, u, so if it is a minimizer, u also satisfies the boundary condition. Okay? This, I think, is something that we said last time. So if I have a minimizer, then it satisfies the PD.
Yes.
Okay. More generally, if you don't have the Dirichlet, so here f xi is equal to, if you don't have the Dirichlet but you have a generic integral like this, what do you find? You find that you do the first variation. So you just take a real lambda and you compute the function h of lambda given phi in leap with compact support, so that you don't destroy the boundary condition, so that this u plus lambda phi has still the correct boundary condition. So you compute this. This is equal to f of grad u plus lambda grad phi. You compute the first variation. You mean this is smooth because f is smooth, strictly convex, etc. So you do h prime of lambda, and h prime of lambda is equal to integral over omega. So you have to differentiate this. and you get this. And if U is a minimizer, 0 is a minimum of H, H is moot, so necessarily H prime of 0 must be 0, and therefore you get the following. That this must be 0 for any phi. And so you get the PDE. Instead of this, you get this minus divergence. Okay. In the case of Dirichlet, this operator, when f of psi is 1 half psi squared, then the gradient is the identity, and so here you have the identity, so this is the divergence of the gradient of U, and this is the Laplacian. Okay. Okay. Now I would like to do with you an exercise. So this says, philosophically say, that a smooth minimizer is a solution of the PDE. Okay, smooth minimizer is a solution. Now we can ask the opposite. Suppose that you have a smooth solution of the PDE satisfying the boundary condition. Can we say that it is a minimizer? You see, this question is maybe more interesting. And this, so in order to understand the variational approach to this kind of problems, so now I would like to do, I ask you, I mean, what do you expect? What do you expect? So let me pause the exercise so that we can try to think about this. So this is exercise 1, say. Okay. Let U satisfy the harmonic in omega and satisfy so can we say that U is a minimizer, or is a minimizer of the problem that I just erased, okay? No? So what happens in one dimension? In one dimension, in general, we cannot say that a stationary point is a minimizer, right? In general, I mean, in one dimension, there is no reason for which, in general, the stationary point of a smooth function is a minimizer, right? But here we have something more on the on our capital F, because capital F actually is convex as a function of U. Therefore, U is convex. So maybe there is the hope that instead of being in this condition, maybe we are in this condition. So, and if you have a minimizer, then if everything is smooth, then maybe, I mean, if you have a stationary point, the only stationary point should be minimizers. Okay. This answer is yes, we have to use convexity. Otherwise, there is no hope to get the exercise. Okay? So, take V in VIP, V in know that, so f is convex, says that f of eta should larger or equal to so for any x, so fix c, okay, do you agree with this? Huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's try to use this in our case, so we have v. So, do you agree with this? It says essentially that the graph of f is above the graph of a tangent plane to f at the point xi.
But I think there should be some order in one dimensional polygon.
Hmm? Some?
Yeah, eta bigger than this.
No, eta and c are vectors. This is the, if you want, this is the first term in the Taylor expansion, right? At xi. Mm-hmm. So this is just the equation of the linear part, and that is the graph of the tangent plane at xi, f of xi. And I'm saying that f at any point is above the graph of the tangent, the graph of the tangent plane. The graph of f is above the tangent plane. Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what this says to us? It says that f of v, which is 1/2 radii squared, must be larger or equal than 1/2 radius square dx plus grad u times v minus u dx. What I'm doing here, do you agree with this, sir? So I am putting in place of eta, I put grad v at x. In place of xi, I put grad u at x. Hmm? Mm-hmm. It is grad v minus grad u, I think. Okay. Next. Hmm? Hmm? Do you agree or not? You're not convinced. You are not convinced?
This is grad u, I think there should be grad u, so maybe one question in this second.
No, because this is the identity, yeah, by the way. When f is 1/2 xi squared, this is xi. Okay. Yeah. It's the identity. Yeah. So I am applying this inequality, let me repeat it, to eta equal grad v at x, at any x. And then xi equal grad u at x. Hmm? Okay? Fine, so if you accept it, are you convinced now? It's okay? You're not so good.
No, I don't see
it. I don't see it. This, do you agree?
Yes.
Or no?
That's
So let me apply that to this case. If that is true, no, sorry, this is U, and this is at X. This is then I integrate.
Yes.
And then I get. Now it's okay.
Yes.
Okay, so now you see what I would like to show is that the energy, the Dirichlet energy of any competitor, V, I want to show that U is a minimizer, right? So I want to show that the energy of this is larger or equal than the energy of this. But there is an additional term. No? And this should be true for any V competitor, because U should be a minimizer in this class. So I have to work a little bit with this, so maybe I can use integration by parts. This.
This is after we have used integration by parts.
Sorry?
After using integration by parts,
yes,
this is what we have.
Yes, because you don't have a boundary term. Why don't you don't have a boundary term here?
Yes. Because in boundary, V and U are the same with G. Yes.
So it's zero.
Yes.
V minus U is zero on the boundary. Okay? Because V is equal to G. And U is equal to G. So V minus U is zero. So, but still there is some term more, but look. Now we use the PD. Okay, so that is zero. So this shows an interesting fact, maybe more interesting than the previous one, that stationary, smooth stationary points of any convex... Okay. You should do this also when F is generic. Of course it's slightly different, but in this case at least, smooth stationary points of the Dirichlet integral are minimizers in the class. So this gives, I mean, a way to go back and forth from the variational formulation to the classical formulation, but we are assuming existence of a minimizer, of course, and here we were assuming existence of a solution of this, and not only existence, but also smoothness, C2 here and C2 here. And we were assuming before a smoothness, a smooth C2 minimizer. So, under smoothness assumption, existence of a solution of the PD or existence of a minimizer and smoothness enough, we have this. And also here, just to have finite energy, we are taking omega bounded and gradient of U bounded because it is Lipschitz. Okay, just to say that this is finite energy. Otherwise, it could blow up. We don't want it. We don't want to treat here stationary points with infinite energy. Because this is, we don't want to do this. Okay. So now I want to introduce another notion now, but I want to see what happens to this kind of proof. What happens to this kind of proof is I take a smooth classical subsolution. So what happens if I have a smooth classical subsolution? Can we still have some sort of minimizing property? So in the sense that actually being a subsolution, is it related to some kind of minimality? We have seen that being a solution is related to minimality, right? This is the two remarks that I have. Now the problem is, instead, if I have a just only subsolution or a supersolution, is this related to some kind of minimality or not? Well, maybe we can try to look a little bit more inside this proof. So, suppose now that you don't have that this is zero, but you have just only a sign, so it is just less than or equal than zero. So we would like this to be, so we want this to be, we want this to be, we need this to be larger or equal than zero, right? If this is larger or equal than zero, so if it is larger or equal than zero, then we can continue the inequality, larger or equal than this plus this, larger or equal than this only. And we still have some sort of minimality. Okay? So we know that this is less, we know that this is less than or equal than zero. Now, so if this is less than or equal than zero, we are done. Okay? So, this says that, I think that we have proven that with the same proof, actually, we have proven the following. So, exercise 2. So, let U in C2 be a smooth, a classical subharmonic function minus Laplace of U less than or equal than 0 in omega and U equal G on the omega. And then f of u is always less than or equal than f of v, but just only for any v one-sided minimality. So a subsolution actually is a minimizer only when I perturb U with something smaller. But I am not allowed to perturb U with something larger. So it is, say, a one-sided minimizer. No? So you perturb U. When you do the computation U plus lambda, suppose this is U, you can compare this only with perturbations which are below U, but not above. If I have an information that U is a minimizer in this sense, I can only deduce an inequality. In the sense that this goes also the other direction. So suppose that you have this. So U is a minimizer in this sense. Suppose that U is also in C2. Then U is a classical subsolution. This is maybe exercise 4. Okay. So it goes also the other direction. So you see, there is actually really another way of looking at things. Instead of looking at the PDE or an inequality, minus Laplace or less than or equal than zero, I can look at minimality or possibly one-sided minimality. The advantage of this, okay, this is, I mean, I can give this definition for any convex C2 integrand. And the advantage is maybe that in order to write this inequality, I just need this to have a sense. So I just need on you to be able to talk about the gradient, first derivative, but not second derivative. So this is some, in some sense, you require less information on you, because you just have to know that there is some notion of gradient, but surely you don't need second derivative to write this expression, right? On the other hand, if you want to write this, if you write it as it is, you need second derivatives. In some sense, so this is, but it is important to have both point of view at the same time. Okay, so now let me give you, so now you have to try to do the exercise, I mean the opposite. If you have an unilateral minimizer, in this sense, under perturbation which are below, you have a subsolution. And you are smooth, then you have a classical subsolution. Classical as a supermodule. Okay, this suggests to start to look at things in a variational sense more deeply, so I need to give you a definition now. So let U be F. So we say that U is a variational, I think it's variational. Let me tell, see how I call it. Variation. U is a variational subsolution. Variational subsolution for F. Oh, some authors call this subminimizer. Or subminimizer. If F of U is less than or equal to F of V for any V in VIP having the same boundary condition as U, and what do we have to add here? So minimality is unilateral minimality, so we can compare U and V having this inequality when V is less than or equal to U. Okay? This is, after our remarks, this is some sort of natural definition. Okay? So you see, if you look at the first lecture, we gave a notion of classical subharmonic, and we require U to be C2. And somebody, maybe you, I don't remember, asked me, why classical? This is a partial answer, because now I'm introducing something which, if it is smooth, is a classical, but now it's Lipschitz, right?
Lipschitz?
Just Lipschitz.
On boundary or inside?
Inside. Okay. So, this is partial answer to your question. This is another notion of subsolution. Of course, I have to call it in a different way. So, that the first lecture, it was classical. Now this is variational, or a subminimizer, or whatever. And then there are other notions of subsolution. This is not the only one. Because, as I told you, you can we can, you can be upper semi-continuous and then define it in another way. So there are various possible definitions. This is another one. Second one. Maybe in this course we will see three or four notions of supersolutions. Okay, now, what is a variational supersolution? Let us try to write it now. We say is a variational supersolution. Super, and here we are super minimizer, maybe. Super minimizer. So what do we have to change in this inequality? We have to be clear.
If you change the sign of this inequalities, if you...
This, no.
This is a...
This is why...
Just
why
this is
right? So minimality we have to keep. But only, so be careful, we don't have to change both. We just have to change the last one. Right? Okay. Okay, so now there is an interesting theorem, not easy. So the let me call it weak comparison. Variational weak comparison principle. So let U be a variational subsolution let V be a variational supersolution suppose that they are ordered at the boundary then they are ordered inside. This is also V. This is a very strong result. This is a quite interesting result. One application, typical application of this. So I think that some of you that have studied PDEs and LTPDs recognize the comparison principle, maybe written in a different way. Usually, one of the standard ways to write it is to say, suppose that U is a classical subharmonic function, suppose that V is a classical superharmonic function, suppose that U is less than or equal than V on the omega, then U is less than or equal than V in omega. Maybe, no? That is the classical for a bounded omega. No? No, you have never seen it. Okay, it doesn't matter, maybe you have seen
it. I have seen this definition in first lecture. You define it as subharmonic function, like AB is harmonic, so if it's smaller than a boundary, so inside.
Ah, that was the weak way of defining a subharmonic function. Ah,
yes.
But you have never seen also
it's
the class.
Subharmonic.
Ah, okay, so, okay. So this is the result. What is a typical interesting application of this result? Suppose that U has a Lipschitz trace by assumption on on the boundary of omega. So suppose that u on the boundary of omega is Lipschitz and is bounded by a constant. Say u is less than or equal than 100 on the boundary, some constant m on the omega. No? Suppose, because you take the maximum of the boundary values of u on the omega. U is Lipschitz, the trace on the boundary of omega is Lipschitz, the boundary of omega itself is Lipschitz, so this is a maximum, and they call it m. So surely you know that u is less than or equal than its maximum on the boundary. Now, if the constant function m is a supersolution, a variational supersolution, you deduce that u is below m also inside. So, this is interesting because it gives you an infinity bound of your minimizer depending only on the infinity bound on the boundary. Okay? Now, usually for our kind of functionals, capital M is a constant, and constants, I mean, are obviously minimizers more than sub minimizer and super minimizer. Actually, they are minimizer because our function depends on the gradient. And the gradient of a constant is zero. So if f of zero, I mean, for the Dirichlet, it's clear. The integrand is this, and f of zero is zero. So constants are minimizer with their boundary data. Right? So this is much more than a super variational super solution. Actually, it's a variational super and sub solution for the Dirichlet. So this gives us immediately some interesting bound in the infinite solution from above and from below. Okay. So let's see the proof of this theorem. So this is maybe the most important tool, one of the most important tools, the comparison principle, or if you, maybe this is called also the weak maximum principle. I prefer it called weak comparison because there is a comparison between two objects. This is, I think, probably the most important tool in studying elliptic PDEs, no? This kind of qualitative result. Okay, let's see the proof. Suppose that U, by contradiction, is not suppose that U is not less than or equal than V everywhere in omega. So we have U, we have V, they are at the boundary U is less than V, but then this is U and this is V. At the boundary U is less than or equal than V, maybe they are equal, but then it happens that V goes below U somewhere. So let me call this set here A, V of X less than U of X. Okay. So what can we say about this A? Is it open? Yes, because U and V are continuous. So this is surely open. contained in omega. Can you say something more? Is it empty?
By assumption. By vertices.
If it's empty, so.
We are assuming that U is not everywhere less than. So if U is not less than or equal than V everywhere, it means that there is at least one point where V is less than U. Yes. Actually, even more than one point. So this is on A. Yes, it is open, so in particular, yes. So, A is not empty. Okay. So, now let me call, we introduce two functions. Let me introduce two functions. Capital M is the maximum between the two, U and V. Let's see. Now, there is a first interesting fact that capital M is still in Lipschitz, because when we do minimum and maximum between two Lipschitz functions, we can maybe introduce, say, angles. No, but still, for two Lipschitz function, it happens that this is still Lipschitz. Okay, so this is still Lipschitz. Okay. Now, capital M is surely larger or equal than V. In omega. But V is a variational super solution. So we can compare the energy of V. Let's see what happens on the boundary. So on the boundary, V is larger or equal than U, therefore on the boundary M and V are equal. Okay? So, if you look at the definition of a variational supersolution, we can compare the energy of V with the energy of something which is above with the same boundary condition. Okay. They have also the same boundary condition. Okay.
Yeah. Yes, means above.
So, this means that F of V. How is the inequality here?
Less than
or equal to.
F of M, and this is zero.
Huh?
Energy of a constant.
This is not a constant.
Yeah.
They just still Lipschitz. Yeah, the same thing. So.
It is the maximum between two functions. Okay. Now, I have to work a little bit on this inequality. So, our function is this, right? So, f of, say, vw is equal to some integral w dx. This is our definition. But this object is local in, if I look, this, what does it mean? Local, sorry. No, not local, it's additive. So this, if I have a subset, a Borel subset of omega, I surely have this sort of additivity. Obviously, by the properties of the integral. So let me call from now on the localization of a some Borel subset simply the integral on that Borel subset. Okay. So let me call this. So this means that we have what? We have that this is equal to f of m in omega in A plus f of m in omega minus A. And this is equal to f of v in A plus f of v in omega minus A. Let's see what is this. In A, the maximum in A of between V and U is U. Okay. Out of A, instead, the maximum is V. Okay, so what do we get? We get, now we can erase things because everything here is finite, I mean everything is positive. So we can erase this with this. So, and we get at least one inequality on A. Okay, so we get that f of v A is less than or equal than f of u. I did this with capital M, which is the maximum. Now let's see what happens if I do with the minimum. Because now I have used only the super solution, the super minima, the variational super solution. But now I want to use also the variational sub solution, so I need to take the minimum. So now let me keep this. And let introduce small m. Where is capital A? Ah, here. Small m is the minimum between this, okay? So let's see what happens. So small m is still in Lipschitz. Clearly, small m is less than or equal than u now. And small m is equal to u on the omega because u, by assumption, is less than or equal than v on the omega. Now, u is a variational subsolution. So we can compare. Sorry, small m is less than or equal than u. Sorry. It's less than or equal than u because it's a minimum u with something. And it is equal to u. So we can compare the energy of u with the energy of something which is below u because u is a variational subminimizer, so variational subsolution. So we can, the energy of u is less than or equal than the energy of something if the something is below. So we have now f of u less than or equal than f of m. Okay. Again, use additivity. We get this. And here we get u and u. Okay. Now let's see what happens in A. In A, this is V. Out of A, it is the minimum is U. So we can erase this with this, and we get that f of u a is less than or equal than f of u. Okay. So what we are using here, you see, is just a sort of abstract property of the structure of the functional capital F. We have not used the fact that this is the Dirichlet integral. We have just used the fact that this is an integral of something for the moment. So it's very general, what I want to say. I'm not using the PDE, the special PDE. I'm just using, for the moment, just the property of the integral as a function of the domain. Okay. So this says that they must be equal. Okay. So let me erase this. So they have the same energy on A. Now I have to use something more. This, now I have to go on and to use some sort of convexity of our, actually strict convexity. Okay? So, and okay. So u is surely equal to v on the boundary of A, by definition of A. Okay. And I'll say the grad of U is different from the gradient of V on a set subset of A of positive measure. Because they are equal to the boundary, they cannot have the same gradient. Okay? Okay, now I need the convexity, as I was telling you. So let us define convex combination. This is a convex combination. Okay. Of course, this is Lipschitz. And we can compare now the energy of W in A. We have that the integrand, so let me write it for you. We have a strict inequality here. Can you see it? This is 1 half u plus 1 half v. It's a complex combination of u and v. And we have, however, that this must be... Why we have a strict inequality?
Because a is bigger than v, so this is omega is smaller than u.
No, you are using the strict convexity of the integral. F, maybe I've written somewhere, but it is clear that this is strictly convex. But the same argument holds for any strictly convex integrand. So the same, the inequality, this holds as soon as f is strictly convex. Because you have this cannot be equal on a set of positive measure. You have strict convexity of capital F is strictly convex up to constant, because it depends, small f depends only on the gradients, and therefore immediately follows that you have this, right? But these, they are the same, okay? So this is equal to f of ua, or equal to, by this, oh, I have erased, they are equal, huh? Okay. Now, let's see what happens on A. So on A, so V, so U and V are the same on the boundary of A, so this implies that V is equal to V on the boundary of A, because I take 1/2 of this plus 1/2 of this, they are equal, and therefore this is equal. And also, V is larger or equal than V on A. Because you see what happens on A, I am summing V plus something larger divided by 2. And this is larger or equal than V. But small v was a super solution. So a super solution. So this clearly falsifies the fact, so the energy of V in A should be less than or equal to the energy of something larger in A. So this falsifies, and since V is a variation of super solution necessarily f of VA must be less than or equal than f of WA, which is contradictory with this. You see? So this is a contradiction, and this proves the theorem. I would like to give you a couple of exercises. As a consequence of this variation of comparison principle. So let U be a variational subsolution, variational super solution. Then exercise 2. Okay. If let U V parameters. Then, so which immediately implies, since u and v have the same trace, this is zero, so which immediately implies that u and v are equal, therefore there is a unique minimizer. So if a minimizer exists, must be unique. So this is not a proof of existence, but is a proof of uniqueness. Supposing existence, then we have uniqueness. Existence is another story.
By one.
Hmm?
By one. By one.
Okay. I mean, this immediately follows from this because you can exchange u and v, because these are at the same time sub-minimizer and super-minimizer. So you can take u minus v and v minus u. So from one it immediately implies two. But one implies uniqueness of minimizers. Okay, so one. Existence is a very difficult problem here, but uniqueness is a consequence of strict convexity, essentially. So here we have, it is clear that what we have used here is strict convexity of the integrand. We cannot expect, if the integrand is not strictly convex in general, we can have flat region, so we cannot expect uniqueness of minimizers. But if you have strict convexity and smoothness, we have. Okay, now, so this is not easy, eh? It's not so easy. Oh, one inequality is trivial. So, by the way, this is a maximum, okay? This is just a remark, I'm not proving it, but this is clearly a maximum. And by continuity, this supremum is the same as the supremum on the closure, which is again a maximum on the closure. Okay. And it is clear that we have an inequality. So this inequality is in, right? Because the supremum on the closure contains the boundary, and therefore it's clear that we have. So the problem is to prove this inequality here in the exercise.
Maximum boundary.
Exactly. It's because of that.
Mm-hmm.
But you might be not having it.
This is a subsolution.
Well, the suggestion could be, so for any x on the boundary of omega, you have ux less than or equal than bx, so you write it as ux minus bx, you write it as bx plus ux minus bx. You can write this, which is less than, on the boundary, less than bx plus the supremum on the boundary of omega of u minus v. Clearly, this is trivial, right? No? Maybe this is a triviality. We here just add and subtract u. Sorry, just add and subtract v. And then you replace this by a supremum. I am on the boundary. Okay? So this is just u. Now this is a constant, right? And now V is a variational super solution, but it's not difficult to check that if V, remark, maybe should do this remark here. This is another structural property of our energy. Remark. If V is a variational, say, super solution, and say K is a constant, then also V plus K is a variational supersolution. The reason for this, from the structural point of view, is that our integral energy is the integrand. The integrand here does not depend explicitly on V, but only on its gradient. And it doesn't see the constants. If instead we work with this kind of energies, then the situation is completely different. So you see, we are not using the structure of the Dirichlet energy to say this, but just say that our integrand depends on V only through its gradient, and not on V itself. Okay. So we are using various structural properties, so let me summarize what kind of structural properties we are using. We are using this, say, U omega. So this is typical property of integrals. So if this capital F is an integral over omega, then clearly we have this property, because integral is additive on Borel sets integration. So this is clear, true. We are using the fact that F has this structure with the integral, with integrand which is strictly convex, smooth enough, strictly convex, depending only on gradient but not on V or X or whatever. And I don't know if, for simplicity, I prefer also to have this. I don't really know where, how much we can relax this assumption. So this is even, this integrand is even, okay? In order that I can change V into minus V and then subsolution, supersolution, exchange. Okay, so the hint here is,
previous from this theorem,
yes, because this is a variational subsolution. This is a variational supersolution, but also this plus C is a variational supersolution. And they have the same trace on the boundary. No, I mean, yes, they have the same trace on the boundary. So, by the previous result, U of X minus V of X, U of X is less than or equal than this also inside. Now you put V on the left, you take the supremum, and you get the difficult inequality. Okay, this is the hint. Did you see the proof? No? Let me repeat it. So you have, this is on the boundary. This is a subsolution. This is a supersolution. They are well ordered on the boundary, and therefore from the previous comparison theorem, this inequality holds also in omega, not only on the boundary, but also in omega. This means that for any x in omega, ux minus vx is less than or equal than this constant. Now you take the supremum on x, and you get this inequality. No? It's clear? Okay, so this So now let me go on. Now let me go back to the Dirichlet integral. So let me go back now to harmonic functions. Okay. Let's see the following theorem. Say. Okay. So let U be such that centered x with radius rho, say, is as is the closure of this is contained in omega, the closure of the ball. Maybe this is not necessary. So we have the Q of x is equal to 1 over n rho to the n. Let's see if I'm able to tell you something. This is a very strong property. It's a very rigid property that holds because we are assuming now we are fixing the integrand. Okay, we are just focusing on the Dirichlet energy, on the Laplacian. Okay. So under this assumption, here it is written that U at some point, so you have omega here, you have a point, you have a ball, U at the center coincides with the mean value of U itself in this ball. Okay, so let me call this like V of U at x, V like volume. This is a volume integral, is the mean value of U, so it's a volume integral, V like volume of U at the point x on the ball of radius rho. Okay, let me use this notation. So, remark, before trying to prove this result, remark. Suppose that U is C2. What do we get from this condition?
We can integrate by parts, and so Laplacian U is zero. For every pi, it's the integral is zero, so U is 1.
Then, so what is it written here? It is written that you have, if you have a classical harmonic function U, then this must satisfy the volume mean value formula. I have written here a stronger statement because I don't know that I can integrate by parts and that I cannot write the Laplacian. So I have written, we used to say that this is the way to write this in the distributional sense, somehow. So if I want to write this in a weak sense, in a distributional sense, what do I have to do? I have to multiply by a test function to take one derivative here and to put it on the other one. Test function has compact support in Omega, so there is no boundary term here. And so in this way I can write something without involving two derivatives, but just one derivative. So as soon as U has some sort of gradient, say as soon as U is in a first of all space, or Lipschitz, say, then this is meaningful. And this is a weak way to write this. No? Is this clear? Or no, it's not clear. Maybe it's not so clear. Okay, questions? Ask me, please.
How the theorem implies this conclusion that
yes.
U is smooth,
suppose that U is not only Lipschitz, it is C2. Right. Okay, if it is C2, I can integrate by parts. What happens here? I can put another derivative here, erasing this derivative here, putting a minus, right? So this becomes divergence of the gradient, which is the Laplacian. This there has no derivatives. And then there is a boundary term. But we don't have boundary term. Okay, so what do I get? I get that this must be equal to zero for any phi. But this is a Lehmann measure theory. Then if this integral is zero for any phi here, and U is smooth, then this the integrand, this must be zero for any x. So this is another way, if you want, to write this PD is a the PD, the same PD written in a sort of distributional way. Okay. I think that you did the seminar distributions. No.
Yes.
So I am saying that the Laplace of U is zero in the weak sense.
Yes. And a conclusion. Can we take C compact, instead of Lipschitz, just C1 compact?
Yes, and if you do with this, you get the same conclusion. Yes. I am using Lipschitz. It is a very stable class. Very symmetric, U and phi are Lipschitz. you can take tests
and see
what... Of course,
Lipschitz is a bigger class. And
yes, Lipschitz is a bigger class. But you can get the same conclusion if you test it with C infinity with compact support, C1 with compact support, and that's it. Okay. So this is the meaning of this this box replaces this if U is not smooth enough. Okay. Now, this is the so-called volume mean value formula, so then U satisfies the volume in the form. Now there is here to show this, there is a clever choice of the test function to make this working. So maybe there is no time today, but I give you, we will do this tomorrow, continue tomorrow. But sorry. Clever choice. Oh, let me call it x naught, maybe. For any x naught, just to be one x naught. Clever choice of test. And this is sort of paraboloid, truncated paraboloid. C of x Okay, so what is this object? Which is the shape? Because you see, we cannot use the PD. So the difficulty here is that we have a stronger statement than the usual one. We don't have a Laplace of U because U is not C2. So we have only this wake form of the PD. And so the only things to do is to use this for proper choice of phi. There is nothing else to do. So there should be some clever choice of phi which gives us some information. Okay. Now, phi, so now we have omega. So we have omega here, and here we have x naught. Okay. Then we have a ball, because we know that the ball of radius law centered at x naught is this ball here on the horizontal plane. Okay. And now we have this function phi. So at x naught, this function is rho squared. Okay. At the center, x equal x naught, rho squared is positive. So what happens when I have on the boundary of the ball?
Zero.
So it's a sort of paraboloid like this. But then I want it to make support compact. So what do I do is this. Just truncate where it is. So, no? So you have here you have your disk, you have this paraboloid, then you truncate it everywhere. Now, you see, we don't, if you write C1, there is a problem, because this truncation is not C1. But with Lipschitz, there are no problems.
You can still do it in C1. It's annoying to
smooth it. So Lipschitz is, in this sense, is useful. So we don't need to smooth it. And so this sort of Lipschitz compact support. So this is an admissible test that we can put here. So I ask you for tomorrow to try to see what happens putting this test. So you have to compute the gradient here and to see what happens, and then tomorrow we conclude. So the gradient is very easy, no? Because the gradient, you see, for a Lipschitz function, the gradient is zero out of the ball. And on the ball, on the boundary of the ball, okay, the gradient is discontinuous, but we don't care because it has zero measure. So we just, so this integral concentrates on the ball. And the gradient is just 2x minus x naught. No? Minus. So we don't care about the 2, we don't care about the minus, so this becomes grad u integral on the ball, grad u at x, scalar product x minus x naught. Okay. This becomes on the ball, of radius rho centered at x naught. Okay. And now you have to use the divergence theorem as usual. No, so the hint is we have grad u at x, scalar product, no? And how should we use the, where is the divergence? Well, we could do the following, we could use the divergence theorem writing this. No? We can expand this divergence. So So this becomes a grad U scalar product plus U of X, but the divergence of X minus X naught, I think, which is N, I think, just N, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. The dimension. Okay. So this means that this integral is the integral of this divergence minus this. And then you should continue to work on this idea. This is the hint. Let's see if something comes out. Okay? So